I come, amen, to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. If I were to use as a topic, subject, title on this beautiful night, amen, God has blessed us as we came up the road, amen, he's still blessing. Don't take the cross for granted. Don't take the cross for granted. A lot of times, amen, we say something like, for granted, don't take your wives for granted. Don't take your parents for granted. Don't take your job for granted. Don't take your children for granted. But oftentimes, amen, we say those words, but I was looking in the dictionary today, it says, to never think about something because you believe it will always be there. You believe, amen, that it will always be there, so therefore you begin to take it for granted. When they told him, amen, save thyself and come down from that cross, the enemy had no idea what the power of the cross meant then and what it means to the people of God today. Again, I come to preach Jesus Christ and him crucified. I come to encourage the saints of God to hold on to God's unchanging hands. I come to prick the heart of the sinner to ask the question, what must I do to be saved? My concern, amen, and I tell the saints all the time, I have a different mindset of being a pastor now. You look at things from a different perspective. What concerns me now, amen, that I see all the time as I travel up and down the highways, amen, an hour drive to work and an hour back from work. I come in contact with all kind of people on the road, amen. You see all kind of vehicles and you see crosses on their license plate. You see them sticking on the back of their windows, amen. You see people wearing them around their neck and their earrings, amen. You even see them tattooed on their arms. But what begins to happen, amen, that they have become accustomed, amen, to just seeing the cross. A lot of times, amen, when you become so accustomed to something that's seen it every day, it becomes desensitized. You forget the true meaning of what the cross really means. When you read the word of God and what God went through on that cross, amen, children should not be allowed to see it. It was a bloody sacrifice. It was something, amen, to be held, amen, those people that witnessed that crucifixion. Sometimes, amen, you might come up on an accident, amen, and see something. They got their body covered. And it's planted something in your mind and say, I'll never forget it. But when you begin to understand the meaning of the cross, I preach in front of a cross every day, amen. Every Sunday morning, there's a cross, amen, behind the pulpit. You walk in, you see this cross, and you ask yourself, what is the true meaning behind this cross? In the Old Testament, amen, they look to the cross. In this dispensation of grace, we're looking back at it. To realize, amen, that they crucified our Lord and Savior, amen. They nailed him to this cross, amen, and it was not a pretty sight. But people, amen, are wearing it, amen, as a badge of honor, amen, not realizing, amen, what the pain and suffering that our Lord suffered on that day. Amen. There are some things, amen, that we look at all the time that we don't even think about what it really means. The circle with a slash through it means that you don't go that way. An arrow means what the word says, one way. How many of you text on today? You see that semicolon on a smile? It means I'm smiling. But when I think of the cross, glory be to God, whether it's silver, gold, or wood, there's something, amen, that pierced my very soul to say, my Savior, amen, hung there between heaven and earth, between two malefactors, that I might have a right to the tree of life. So when I see the cross, amen, it's not just a piece of jewelry to me. It's not just something, amen, that I can see tattooed on somebody, amen. It's not just something that I can see on a bumper sticker. It means much more to me than that. When I think about the cross, sometimes, amen, people you see on TV, they got this cross they trying to ward off the enemy. How many know, amen, it ain't the power, amen, that piece of wood they have. It's the power of the Holy Ghost that's in the individual. Some people, amen, had it hanging over their bed and say, listen, this cross is going to protect me. But if you don't know, amen, the pardon of your sins, that cross means nothing to you. It's not going to protect you, amen. But God. Let me hit you with a scripture. It says, Galatians, amen, the third chapter, verse number 13, says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is every man that hangeth from a tree. Saints of God, amen, we serve, amen, a risen Savior.
Yes.
How do you know, amen? Because I was once dead in trespasses and sin, and because he lives.
Yes.
Amen. Because, amen, that he got up, amen, just like he said.
Uh-huh.
We got to realize, amen, that we cannot take this cross for granted.
Yes.
Why are you saying this to us, Pastor? I know what the cross means. Understand that the meaning behind the cross, amen, goes much more deeper, amen, than what we really think it is. Because there was one, my God, named Simeon that was in the temple.
Uh-huh.
In Luke, amen, the second chapter, the Holy Ghost, amen, spoke to him and said, you're not going to see death, amen, until you see the Lord's cross.
Come on.
You see, so when he saw him, amen, that Mary, amen, and Joseph brought him, amen, to the temple to present him according to the law. And as they brought him, amen, he realized this is the Lord's Christ. But he said something, amen, to them that made them, amen, marvel at what he was saying. How many know, amen, when you become, amen, born, the Bible said a man of a, born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. But this was no ordinary birth. This was no ordinary child, glory be to God. He said to him, he said, this child is for the rise and fall. Meaning that, listen, he's going to rise, he's going to get up. Can you imagine someone telling your child, amen, about he's just being born and he's going to die? But not only is he going to die, he's going to get up again. So when you begin to understand that that Mary kept this thing, amen, that realizing that she is raising somebody that's on his way, amen, to die. But as saints of God, when you come into the body of Christ and you baptize in Jesus' name, man, it's a death.
Uh-huh.
It's a spiritual death, amen, because you rise up in the newness of life.
Yeah.
Don't take the cross for granted. A lot of times we begin to ask ourselves, amen, you mean to tell me I can't wear this cross around my neck because of... I'm not saying you can't do that. What I'm saying is understand the meaning behind the cross. The cross. The Bible says, amen, in 1 Corinthians, the third chapter, the first chapter, chapter 23, says it's an offense. It's an offense. Because why is it an offense? Because, amen, they nailed him to the cross. They nailed an innocent person to the cross. Pastor, why is that so offensive? Because what began to happen is when they nailed him to that cross, sometimes, amen, Pilate said, I find no fault in him. When he found no fault in him, they still said, crucify. So they crucified a man, an innocent man, but he wasn't just a man, he was God manifested in the flesh. So when I say God manifested in the flesh, glory be to God, that God wrapped himself, amen, in flesh. He stepped out of glory and said, I'm going to come and redeem sin for mankind. I'm going to come, amen, and redeem them from the curse of the law. Glory be to God. You got to understand something. That when we say, amen, to redeem, amen, it means to buy back.
Yeah.
We was all dead in trespasses in sin. Right? But God didn't leave us there. Adam left us there, amen, because he was the first man, amen. He died, and because of he died, amen, in sin. He brought sin, and we all died in Adam. The first Adam. But the second Adam, glory be to God, is Jesus Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
And through him we have life and life eternal.
Yeah, yeah.
but the cross. I want to focus, amen, because he said the cross is foolish to some. The foolishness, amen, of preaching to some is foolish, amen, but to us that believe, it's the power of God unto salvation and wisdom. So therefore, amen, the cross just means more than a piece of jewelry around my neck. Glory be to God. We got to realize, amen, when John saw him, he said, behold the Lamb of God that is slain before the foundation of the world. You got to get it, saints. This is a lamb, glory be to God. I'm not doing a Bible study, but I want you to realize, amen, that everything that Jesus did is fulfillment, amen, of the scripture and fulfillment of prophecy. So therefore, he couldn't have came down off the cross. If he had came down off the cross to save someone else and just to prove who he was, then all those prophets, my God, would have died in vain. Because they looked for this moment and did not see it. But blessed are we that we're looking back to the cross because he lives. Because, my God, because he lives. You can face tomorrow. You can get to your next praise. You can get to your next praise. When God gave me that, he says, the next praise. Sometimes the enemy, amen, he comes in this day and age. Can I come down for a little bit? We have to do more with less. On our jobs, sometimes in the house of God, do more with less. Pressure on every side. Yes, we're stressed. Yes, we are. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But he's saying, because I rose again on the third day, declaring all power in my hand, you can live this life, amen. Glory be to God. The Bible said the way of the transgressor is hard. But for the saint of God, when you got the Holy Ghost down on the inside of you, and it's a mighty burning fire. I might have made a mistake yesterday. I might have ran into this today. But God said, the next praise. Get to the next praise. Don't dwell, amen, on what children ain't acting right. Get to the next praise. Husband, wife ain't acting right. Job is not acting right. Car is not acting right. But get to the next praise. The enemy, amen, he wants to cause the saints of God. He wants to get us in a point, amen, that we have a pity party. He wants to get us to a point that we complain about everything. But when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he went through on that cross, who am I to complain? Because he brought me out of darkness into his marvelous light. And therefore, my God, I have a right to get to that next praise. And when I get to that next praise, glory be to God. To stay there by myself, I can connect with somebody else, and let's praise God together, because he dwells in the midst of praises. But if I'm all alone by myself, I still can muster up a praise. He knows, he's acquainted, my God, with every situation that I'm going through, every minor detail of my life, God knows about. What a praise me. He was coming down to Jerusalem. And they were singing Hosanna. The Pharisees got upset and said, stop them from doing that. He said, listen, if they don't praise me, the rocks are going to cry out. I don't want no rock crying out to me because he lives. The word, because when you think about it, because, amen, it sets a fact of something that's already taken place. Let me give you an example. I fell asleep because I was tired. I didn't go to work today because I was sick. Because of Calvary. Because of Calvary, my God. I can face, amen, that supervisor on the job. I can go to the pastor's office. You got to get it, sis.
Come on.
I can go to the pastor's office and say, Pastor, I need to talk to you for a minute. Right. Instead of circumventing going around him, and I can come boldly before the throne of Christ. Yes. This is what you got to realize. When Christ was crucified, yes. The Bible said that the veil of the temple rent from top to bottom, glory to God. It means that he opened the access, amen, that once we did not have a right to do it. It was only up to the high priest to make intercessory, amen, for the people of God only once a year. And that once a year, all it did was roll the sins ahead. But our great high priest. With my sacrifice. In other words, amen, I don't have to come down with two turtle doves. I don't have to identify. See, you are tied to your sacrifice. And everybody knew what you had done. But now, God, I can come to the altar, glory be to God. Ain't nobody long between me and God. What I did last night, hallelujah. What I did. And stand before the priest and say, Lord, forgive me. Listen, who wouldn't serve a God like that? So when he opened up the holiest of holies, I don't know if you realize the priest is now out of a job. Glory be to God. What am I going to do now? What will I do now? Glory be to God. I'm going to walk in this newness of life, amen. No more blood sacrifice for my sins. It's a sacrificial life to present your body. A living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. I'm a pastor. I think we established that. So I know, glory be to God, what happens in church. I know about the saints. I can say, amen, they're late for Sunday school. They stop paying tithes. They upset. I know all of that. So that's not nothing new, glory be to God. But I can tell you right now, as a pastor, I want you to realize that the pastor standing watch for your very soul. So get yourself together as I'm still going to come to the house of God. Yeah, I might have messed my tithes up, but I'm still going to come to the house of God and say, Lord, forgive me. The saints say, amen, they don't want to get it right, said glory be to God. You need to deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow Jesus. What does it mean to pick up this cross?
Hallelujah.
It's not a physical cross. It means to deny this flesh. It means to put away some things. It means to lay aside the sin and the weight that sometimes so easily besets. Saints of God, you're in the right place at the right time. Things are happening all around us.
Yes, Lord.
The righteous man, God. We have a hiding place. We have a refuge. It's in the house of God. Where can the righteous go? Glory be to God. We need to get to that next praise. Sometimes, amen, it's a hindrance. That cross was a stumbling block. But whatever you're going through in your life, make that stumbling block a stepping stone. See, a stepping stone, glory be to God, does not cause you to step down, but it calls you to go a little higher, my God. How many want to go higher in the Lord? So whenever you slip and fall, glory be to God, pick yourself up, confess that thing, and move on, my God, to the enemy of your soul. The Bible said that the enemy had a known. See, God take the foolish things to confound the wise. Who would have thought, amen, a cross, my God? Oh, glory be to God. Who would have thought a cross, my God, can cause us, amen, who was not, amen, a part of Israel. Part of Jews, who is Gentiles, and he made the twain one by his cross. Sometimes, amen, we use excuses, amen, to tell them, we say all excuses are nailed to the cross.
Yes.
And they are nailed to the cross. But what you got to realize, amen, how are you carrying your cross. Are you carrying them in such a way, man, that people don't know who you are? I tell them on my job all the time. They call me by my last name, Todd. They said, Todd, what are you doing this week? I'm going to Connecticut. You driving over there for a church service? Praise be to God for a church service. If you would drive all that way and see the Pittsburgh Steelers, why can I drive all this way to praise him and the truth and living God? Why can I drive in there 6 hours to be with the people of God? It's your perspective of how you see things. Glory be to God. I'm telling you. Oh my God. Oh, hallelujah. I want to help somebody. I want to help somebody. Glory be to God. I can feel it, amen, down in my sanctified soul. They spat on him. They called him all kinds of names. Today they picked on him. They bullied him. Glory be to God. It's a bully.
My God.
People are dying because somebody sent them a text. People are dying because somebody said something on Facebook. How many got a tablet with you right now? There's an on-off switch on that thing, isn't it? There's an on-off switch on it. You seen one? You seen the on-off switch?
Yes.
Teaching them to just turn it off. It's just that simple. Turn it off. But what has happened is that the enemy of our soul, amen, has put it to a point that we have to have it. Glory be to God. I'm not against technology. But technology is hurting the saints of God. I'm trying to help somebody, Pastor.
Amen.
We got our Bibles on our phones, don't we?
Amen.
Yeah, we do. But every time we try to read the Word of God, what begins to happen? The phone rings. Somebody texting you. Come on, saints, come on. When you go down to pray, you put that phone on silence. It lights up. Because you're praying with one eye. Nothing new. You're praying with one eye open. Prayer is at 7 o'clock. Turn it off to 8.
Thank you, Jesus.
If the Lord wants you, trust me, he'll reach out and touch you.
Amen.
But God touches you through the power of the Holy Ghost. That's the touch that I want to feel from the Lord. Not somebody buzzing my phone. I want to feel a touch from God. And I know, my God, that he hears my prayer. Don't take the cross for granted. There are a lot of things that saints of God we begin to take for granted. We begin to take the fellowship among the saints of God for granted.
Amen.
The Bible said, neglect not to assemble yourselves together as a man of some is. I can watch TV. I can watch the pastor on YouTube. But that's not the word of God. Understand something, saints. Nothing supersedes the word of God.
Amen.
Nothing takes the place of the word of God. If it's not in God's word, you think about it for a minute. The adversary wants to move you out from God's word.
Amen.
How has he done it? Ask yourself, how has I moved from the word of God? How have I moved from the house of God? Saints, these are the last in evil days.
Amen.
We have got to get to a point that we realize, amen, that my next breath might be my last. I didn't come, glory be to God, 6 hours to tell you about things in the church. I came to preach about Christ and him crucified.
Amen.
But what am I saying, amen? But I believe what God is saying to us that don't take me for granted.
Amen.
Don't take my life for granted. Don't take what I did on the cross for granted.
Jesus.
The Bible said we're in the world, but we're not of the world. So when I come into God's house and I see the saints of God, I say, praise the Lord. How are you doing today?
Thank you, Lord.
How many of us keep walking? Praise the Lord, how you doing? Stop and listen. I thank God for Higher Hope Temple. One thing, amen, I told him, Pastor King, don't ever turn the lights on the saints of God.
Amen.
If they want to stay there all night and talk, let them talk. Here's the keys, lock it up. Lock it up. Because what's beginning to happen is, amen, that we're so busy trying to get back to something when the saint of God is trying to talk to you. Say, I got trouble in my marriage. I need you to talk to me. I got trouble with my children. I need somebody to listen to me. But when you turn the lights out, they're going back to trouble. There's safety in the house of God. There's victory in the house of God. There's a place in it that we can get to the house of God. I thank and praise God we did. We hugged one another.
Yes,
we went on our way out the door. We were still in service. We got to put the devil on notice.
Hallelujah.
An attack on my sister is an attack on me. An attack on my brother is an attack on me. If you mess with my brother, then you mess it with me. Fight on our knees. Fight in prayer. Fight with the word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit. Don't allow, my God, somebody tell you about your brother or your sister. You ask me a question, are you praying for? If they said no, then you keep it moving. I've been where you sit. I've been there. Pastor, bishop, elder, we've been there. The thing, amen, that I want to leave with the saints of God. Because I'm telling you, when you think about the death on that cross, it was some serious pain that was going on. When he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Before he got to that point, he said he was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. It was like drops of blood. It was agony that was going on. Imagine your toothache 100 times worse. Imagine childbearing 100 times worse. Imagine trying to pass that kidney stone 100 times worse. The Bible says he was beaten beyond recognition. Glory be to God. That's what the cross means to me. A lot of times, amen, you come up on an accident or you see something that was in a fire, the only way they can identify is through their dental records. The only way they can identify them is that there's a mark somewhere on their body. How are you being identified? Are you bearing the marks of Christ in your body? How was Christ identified? The Roman soldier said, truly this was the Son of God. How did they identify? Because he humbled himself unto death.
Yes.
Now listen, that scripture says unto death and says even the death of the cross.
Yes.
There's two deaths that are saints that we got to realize. We got to die to self. And there's a spiritual death. There's a natural death that we have to die of. When we go down, my God, in the watery grave, it's a death. But then we got to die daily. It ain't once saved, always saved. How many got something going on right now?
Amen.
Come on now. I got something going on right now.
Amen.
But do you believe God?
Yes.
can work it out. We believe in it, that mansion, my God. So what about those situations? I know God can work it out. But listen what happens. Before we even make altar call, the enemy says, just sit there. Don't go anywhere. He says, sit there in your seat because it's still the same old, same old. But I'm here to tell you, the devil is a liar.
Yes.
The Bible says he's the father of lies. You got the power of the Holy Ghost down on the inside of you. He said one can chase a thousand. Two, 10,000. Don't find yourself, I used to tell him, Revis Island. Anybody know who Darrell Revis is? Don't know him? Okay, he's a football player. He's a corner, man, that sits out there and he got the best of him back in his youth.
That's right.
Huh? Yeah, he knows up there. Don't let the enemy think that you can you can fight out there by yourself.
Uh-huh.
If you find yourself out there by yourself, I'm here to tell you, you're in the wrong. Get with a saint of God. Get with a seasoned saint. Get with somebody, man, that can speak into your life and say, you can make it.
Yes.
We sing the song, Jesus said, if you lean on me, I won't let you fall.
Yes.
Saints of God, lean on each other. God won't let you fall.
All right.
Why won't he let you fall? Because his word already says so. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. When you begin, amen, to realize what this cross really means, it means more than a symbol, a tattoo, a bumper sticker,
yes,
a necklace, your earring. There's going to come a time when they're going to say, oh, you're a Christian, huh? No, I'm not. Why is that cross on your neck? Why is that cross on your bumper sticker then? When you deny him or you say, I know him. Peter denied him three times. He had issues. But on the day of Pentecost, he said this.
Hallelujah.
Once the Holy Ghost comes, you're going to have power. I believe in that, saints. Because that's what the Lord says in Acts 1 and 8. Once the Holy Ghost comes, you're going to have power. If you ain't got the Holy Ghost, you got to get it. I came up, my God, when it was on Wednesday, it was prayer and tarry. You got down on your knees and you start tearing for the Holy Ghost. You came week after week until you got it. You're going to need to get out of here. Don't be deceived. Because the enemy said, listen, you don't need the Holy Ghost. He said, if you have not the Spirit of Christ, you know who he is. You know who he is. How many of you are married in here right now?
Amen.
Alright, I'm looking. Where are you ready to ring at? Hold your, you got your head, got your head. Why did I ask words on the, I was in the wrong hand. Men, keep it on, wear it, okay? There are some honest women out there that say, oh, he's married, leave him alone. Women, the same thing. Where are your, there are some honest men that never say, oh, she's married. See, some things, saints of God, keeps us out of trouble.
Amen.
If you're committed to your husband or to your wife, put that ring on. Glory be to God. See, it'll drive some of them dogs out. Yes, it will.
Ain't no dog with no old.
It keeps us out of some trouble. John said, you can play a little softer. After he rose, and I'm gonna wrap this up, I can't see the time. My pastor, former pastor, Elder Baker, he used to say, in my closing. And he'll close about 30 times. But John said, he said, I'm not gonna believe until I see the nail prints in his hands. He said, I'm not going to believe, amen, until I can put my hand into his side. That's how he identified that this is the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. How many of you have seen the Lord? Haven't seen it. Because he said, blessed are those who believe and who have not what? Have not seen. He said, through their word. So as saints of God, anybody got their Bible with them right now? Hold it up for a minute. You got it? Don't come to church without your Bible. You got it? This is your weapon. See, you can show up with any fight and win with that in your hand.
Amen.
Because man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. If you believe that Jesus is an example, then he said, it is written. When you use it is written, glory be to God, the enemy already knows he's defeated. Amen. See, I like to sing, but I can't sing. I like to shout, but only when the Holy Ghost hits me.
Amen.
I like to praise him, my God, when the praise team is on high. But I love the word of God.
Amen.
See, when you get along by yourself with the word of God, you got to decide more than your what? Necessary food. So when you take the word of God into your hand, he said, hide the word of God to that you might not sin. How to wear in your heart. It means up here that you might not. Come on, Bible scholars. That I might not sin against you. But if we sin, we have an advocate who's just and righteous enough to forgive. Get it right. Get it right. Get it right. Get right with God. Do it and do it now. Tomorrow is not promised to us. God's not the same yesterday, today, and forever. Can I talk to the men for a minute? Men, listen. The Bible says, love your wife as Christ loved the church. Love them. Love them. Love them. The enemy is after you men because he understands, amen. He said, love. Love, love them as Christ loved the church. I asked the question, how many men, amen, were willing to give their lives for their wives? They step in front of a bullet, step in front of a car, they're willing to die for. But what about that football game? What about that nice shiny car that you wax every day? Can you die to that? That's what he's talking about. Can you die to some things? To show forth the love of Christ, saints of God, friends, people of God, it's a blessing to be found in the house of God.
Amen.
On a Friday night.
Amen.
When I realized, I said, it's another Friday night, I'm still saved because before I got saved, Friday night, about this time, I don't want to take people back, but I want you to understand that we was getting ready to go out into town. But look where you are now. Tell the Lord, thank you. I'm sitting among the saints of God. I'm praising God. I'm giving God the glory. And I'm listening to a man from Salisbury, Maryland, trying to tell me all about myself. Isn't God a good God? This cross, don't take it for granted. Think to your next praise. That's what God's word is, the next praise. Pastor, how am I going to get there? If there's sin in your life, you got to get it out of there. You cannot get to your next praise in sin. Let's stand to our feet before Pastor Keeney's come. Glory be to God. What Calvary did, the Bible said we were all dead in trespasses and sin. It made a difference in our life, amen, that the sins of the world, he who knew no sin became sin for us. That meaning that that was a transformation that took place. He died in our stead. The sins, amen, that he bore the sins of us. Can you imagine that? That's what the agony was. when he said it is finished, amen, that everything that the Father had given him to do is finished. He didn't say, I'm finished. He says, it is finished. It's finished. If you're going through something in your life right now, speak it into your life and say, it's finished. When I say it's finished, it means that I'm willing to take the next step to say, I can forget those things that are behind me and begin to press. Because soon we leave these doors, he will say, it wasn't nothing. But tell the devil he's a liar. Because it is finished. Because what Christ did, because he lives, I can face. Saints, we serve a true and living God. He rose again on the third day, declaring all power in his hands. Saints, do not, I beseech you by the mercies of God, do not take the cross for granted. Get to the next praise. Pray for me in Jesus' name.